What's up, you beautiful bastards? Hope you're having a fantastic Tuesday. Welcome back to the Philip DeFranco Show, and let's just jump into it. And the first thing we're going to talk about today is an update to a story that has just blown up the world of entertainment and music over the past 2 weeks, and that is Machine Gun Kelly and Eminem. And it's been a big deal in the world of hip-hop. You had Eminem releasing his album Kamikaze, where he fired shots at a ton of people. And one of the people that was mentioned, Machine Gun Kelly, responded with his own song towards Eminem called Rap Devil, and then Eminem responded with Killshot. And in general online, you saw a lot of fans saying, oh, this guy did better, that guy, his career is ended. But personally, I thought that this was a win-win for both artists. Machine Gun Kelly had a number one song on iTunes. And on the other end, Eminem, who really didn't need it anyway, but got a lot more attention around his album that just released. Win-win in my eyes. But over the past 24 hours, something interesting happened. On Instagram, Machine Gun Kelly posted this picture. You see him in what appears to be a stadium full of people flipping the bird with the caption, he missed, hashtag leg shot, hashtag rap devil still number one, hashtag let's talk about it. Which, I mean, if you look at that picture, that looks like a definitive statement. Machine Gun Kelly won. But it turned out there was another side to the story. We saw comments popping up on the picture like this one, saying, tell them the truth, Kelly. Let them know this was Fall Out Boy's crowd. Let your fans know that you had on a jacket and ask the crowd if they can put their middle fingers up for a picture. Not telling them what the picture is for. Tell them how you turned away from the crowd, took off the jacket to expose that shirt, then had the pic taken, then got booed when you revealed that shirt to the crowd. Stop faking. Now, of course, the thing to consider here is that and the other comments are just that, they're comments. But unfortunately for MGK, there is a video of the aftermath of the reveal where he tries to perform Rap Devil, which, and I say try, because he does, but it is hard to hear him over the booing.
So I gotta say,
now granted, you do hear a cheer or two there, but it definitely leads me to believe that he lied to that audience for that picture. An audience which, as that previous comment pointed out, was there for Fall Out Boy because he is opening for Fall Out Boy. And to me, this seems just like a massive, easily avoidable, self-inflicted wound, as the kids would call it, a major L. But MGK does legitimately have the number one spot on iTunes for a single rap devil, so why openly lie like this? I mean, the thing the internet hates the most is a liar, so why? But that's where I'll leave that story, and I'll pass the question off to you. What do you feel around this? Do you feel like stories like this lend themselves to nothing matters, even bad press is good press, because he's about to come out with an album? Maybe he's also counting on people hate listening to it on Spotify? Or no, that was an accident, or maybe this is just a self-inflicted wound, he's not that smart. Any and all opinions, I'd love to hear from you in those comments down below. Then in quickie news, because if I have to have this mental image, everyone has to have this mental image. If you were wondering today why Mario Kart and Toad were trending, you didn't tap the text. They're not trending because we got a surprise release of Mario Kart or Captain Toad Treasure Tracker. They were trending because The Guardian got an early copy of the new Stormy Daniels book, and they decided to share a part of that book called Full Disclosure, where she says that she's having sex with Donald Trump, writing, I lay there, annoyed that I was getting fucked by a guy with Yeti pubes and a dick like the mushroom character in Mario Kart. Not quite Hemingway, but it does paint a picture. A picture I would like to burn, but much like a song you're trying to forget, the more you try to forget it, the more you think about it, and so I've decided to share this visual with you. You're welcome. Then we had some news around the world of gaming. First up, you had the seemingly unstoppable professional gamer Ninja, aka Tyler Blevins, being the first professional gamer on a cover of ESPN magazine. And one, I think this is fantastic for the community. It's fantastic as far as the legitimacy of professional gaming. And two, just from the standpoint of someone that loves seeing something that came from the internet being publicly accepted or breaking in to the mainstream, it's been amazing to watch Ninja and others just knocked down first. But also on the note of Fortnite, we got interesting information thanks to Ryan Wyatt, the YouTube head of gaming. While in the world of gaming, everyone's talking about Fortnite. Fortnite's the biggest thing. Everyone is playing Fortnite. Well, according to Ryan Wyatt, it's actually not the biggest thing on YouTube, which sounds negative, but also means it has a bunch of room to grow. Wyatt's saying, Fortnite has certainly been a massive contributor to the growth on gaming, but Minecraft is still our biggest game globally. Fortnite has not taken off in every single market. Adding, it's a very westernized look when you look at just the Fortnite lens of how big Fortnite has been. But when you start to look at these other countries and regions, we're actually seeing explosive growth from the mobile gaming category that's pretty underrepresented in the West. Games like Mobile Legends Bang Bang and Arena of Valor, which I guess really shouldn't be the most surprising news, because just back in January, you had PC Gamer reporting that Minecraft had 74 million active players, which was a new record for the game when it happened back in December, which is crazy to think that that even happened so many years after it was released. But also, as far as why is the head of YouTube Gaming talking with the media, it's because there was also another announcement. And that's because YouTube made a massive announcement today that gaming on YouTube is changing. Specifically, you go to youtube.com/gaming and it no longer looks like hot garbage. You've got a clean featured carousel at the top. You have top live games just under that. Gaming videos from your subscriptions right under that. Top live streams. Additionally, on the full YouTube trending page, they'll have gaming creator on the rise carousels. Along with these changes, YouTube will also be retiring the YouTube gaming app in March of 2019, which personally I think makes sense. I mean, they're trying to get everyone to do things through YouTube, and then you had this kind of confusing standalone app. And it makes sense why YouTube's actually paying attention and giving the gaming community some love here, not only because it's a place that they hope to grow, but because Ryan Wyatt says that there are 200 million daily logged in users watching gaming on YouTube, which if true is massive, because if you compare that to Twitch's daily active users, that comes in at around 15 million. But that's also thinking about those companies as competitors, which they are, but for the actual users on the platform, we've seen mutual success. I mean, take Ninja, for example. He is associated heavily with Twitch. He has broken Twitch records, but at the same time, because of that, he has become one of the fastest growing gaming channels we've ever seen on YouTube. And that's why I love seeing YouTube step up their game, because all of this competition is breeding a better environment for the creators on them. But a question I do want to pass off with this story for the gamers out there, the people that are consuming gaming content, where do you find yourself watching the most? And also, why do you think you have that platform of choice? But from that, I want to share some stuff I love today and today in Awesome, brought to you by BetterHelp.com/DeFranco. And BetterHelp, if you don't know, is the fantastic place and service where you can get affordable private online counseling. Right on your computer, your tablet, your phone, you get access to a licensed, trained, experienced, accredited psychologist. You can do it on your schedule via text, audio, video. All you've got to do is go to BetterHelp.com/DeFranco. You fill out a questionnaire, they match you with a counselor, and you can start counseling today. It's a service I personally use, it's a service I personally recommend, and if you'd like to try it out, just remember, go to betterhelp.com/DeFranco or click the link in the description down below. And the first bit of awesome is, after long last, we got our official trailer for Captain Marvel. March 2019 cannot come soon enough. Then we got the launch trailer for the Shattered Bloodline DLC for Dead by Daylight. Then we had a movie accent expert breaking down actors' accents. We had a TED Ed on why you should read Edgar Allan Poe. We got the opening monologue for the Emmys. Then we had Nicolas Cage breaking down his most iconic characters. We also got the honest trailer for Jurassic World Fallen Kingdom. Then we had Netflix announcing a live-action series based on Avatar The Last Airbender. Then we had Thrillist giving us 100 tips to make better pasta. And the last bit of awesome is a bunch of you guys yesterday said that you were not getting your regular notifications for yesterday's Philip DeFranco show. And as always, I don't know what to tell you. It's YouTube. Just remember, I post here every weekday at the very least. And if you missed yesterday's show, I'll include it in the outro card that you can click, or just I'll link to it down below in the description. And if you want to see the full versions of everything I just shared, the secret link of the day, really anything at all links, as always, are in the description down below. And then let's talk about the massive updates around Brett Kavanaugh. And of course, where we left this story yesterday, you had Brett Kavanaugh, Supreme Court nominee, being accused by Christine Blasey Ford. She's a 51-year-old clinical psychology professor who has accused Kavanaugh of trying to sexually assault her back in high school. Kavanaugh denied this. Ford, who was initially anonymous, then came forward and said, no, if my story is going to be told in bits and pieces, I'm going to tell it. You had the Senate Judiciary Committee deciding whether or not to delay the scheduled Thursday vote on moving Kavanaugh's nomination forward to the full Senate. We had both Kavanaugh and Ford saying they're willing to testify in front of the committee about this alleged incident. As of today, we know what is happening. It's no longer a hypothetical situation. The vote has officially been delayed, and both Kavanaugh and Ford have been invited to testify in front of the committee on September 24th. And according to Senate Judiciary Chairman Chuck Grassley, there will not only be a new hearing, but it will be televised to the public as well. And as far as the specifics around this event, in an interview with radio host Hugh Hewitt, Grassley said that as of right now, they hadn't made up their mind who would go first, but that he assumed that Ford would. But also adding that at that time, Ford had not officially responded yet to the committee's invitation, which led to questions about whether the proceedings might be delayed even further. Grassley also saying this about the hearing.
The accusers deserve to be heard, and after they're heard, we also have a responsibility to hear Judge Kavanaugh, and I want to hear from Dr. Ford. And she deserves to be heard because these are serious accusations.
And Hewitt also asked Grassley about how Ford would be treated.
Can you assure Dr. Ford and her counsel that she will be treated respectfully, graciously, and be allowed to testify at length without interruption or badgering?
Absolutely. I have a reputation for running the committee that way.
There have also been some calls from Democratic lawmakers to allow others to testify during the hearing, such as Kavanaugh's friend, who was allegedly in the room during this incident. But on that note, Grassley said that only Ford and Kavanaugh would be allowed to testify. Also, yesterday we talked about the support that Kavanaugh had been receiving. One specific point involving a letter that was allegedly signed by 65 women saying that Kavanaugh was a great guy. Well, after that, we had the alumni of Ford's high school circulate a letter of support as well. And that group of women writing that Ford's allegation against Brett Kavanaugh is all too consistent with stories stories we hear and lived while attending Holton. And that was signed by over 200 women, including Julia Louis-Dreyfus. Also, on a more personal level, one of Ford's friends came forward in an effort to lend more credence to her accusations against Kavanaugh. In an interview with Mercury News, Ford's friend and neighbor Rebecca White said that in 2017, she posted her Me Too story on Facebook about being raped as a teenager. And after that post, she says that Ford reached out to her, saying she reached out to me afterwards, supporting me and my story, and that she had something happen to her when she was really young, and that the guy was a federal judge. She said she had been assaulted. She said hers had been violent as well, physically scary, fighting for her life. Now, ultimately, that is where we are right now, and we're gonna have to see what actually happens on Monday. But as far as what's happening now, you have some saying that not allowing corroborating witnesses to testify is similar to what happened with Anita Hill. People referencing how she came forward with allegations of sexual harassment against then Supreme Court Justice nominee Clarence Thomas in 1991. But also an update on that note, as we were finishing up today's show, Washington Post reported that they had a letter from Mark Judge where he said, "I have no memory of this alleged incident," and he defends Kavanaugh. Also, according to Axios, the GOP is most worried about Jeff Flake voting against Kavanaugh, even more so than moderate pro-choice Republican Senators Murkowski and Collins. But ultimately, we're gonna have to wait to see how this develops and what happens on Monday. And then let's talk about the fallout from Hurricane Florence, which pounded the East Coast this past weekend. At its peak, it was a Category 4. It has now been downgraded to a post-tropical cyclone, though the threats of flooding are still ongoing. So far, the reports are that 32 people have died, 25 in North Carolina, 6 in South Carolina, and 1 person in Virginia. Also, over the weekend, we saw Hurricane Florence spin off several tornadoes. In fact, just yesterday in Virginia, there were 16 tornadoes reported to have sprung up because of the storm. Also, according to the North Carolina Department of Safety, there have been 2,600 rescues as of yesterday, with 300 pets being rescued. Although, a note here, those rescues do not include volunteer rescues or individuals just helping others. As far as rainfall, we saw record-breaking rainfall in the Carolinas, with the highest being 35.93 inches recorded near Elizabethtown, North Carolina. And that just crushed North Carolina's previous record. That previous one being set back in 1999 during Hurricane Floyd at 24.09 inches. Also, according to Duke Energy officials, 1.1 million people lost power in the storm, and some of the hardest hit areas may not have power for weeks. FEMA has also said that at least 4 dams have breached in the Carolinas. And according to Hal Austin, an NWS meteorologist, flooding is still going to be a concern into the weekend and into next week. And as far as the rainfall over the Carolinas, it has become scattered. The heaviest rains, though, have begun moving into the northeast, where flood warnings have already been issued. And as of right now, the storm is expected to finish up raining today and move offshore by tomorrow. However, the rivers are still expected to continue rising and remain elevated throughout the week. There are also concerns about what is in the water. According to Axios, at least 4 power plants that store coal ash have reported some type of breach in containment. And according to the Washington Post, near Lake Sutton, Tropical Storm Florence has poured so much rain on the state that the wall of a coal ash landfill near the lake has failed in several places, washing away more than 2,000 cubic yards of toxic waste, enough to fill more than 150 dump trucks. Additionally, there are concerns about hog farms and their waste lagoons. And on that specific note, reportedly the North Carolina Pork Council says the lagoons holding hog feces and urine are supposed to safely absorb at least 19 inches of rain, and that ahead of the storm, many were prepared for more than 25 inches, but Florence has dumped that much or close in some areas. But as far as the full impact, we're ultimately gonna have to wait to see what happens. I imagine many people watching, along with myself, obviously we send our best wishes, but also, if you would like to help in one of a number of ways, down below I'll be including links where you can donate to the Red Cross, the North Carolina Disaster Relief Fund, United Way Hurricane Florence Recovery Fund, One South Carolina Fund, and the Virginia Disaster Relief Fund. And that's where I'm going to end today's show. But of course, I always want these videos to be a conversation, so whether it be the last story, the first one, anything in between, let me know what you're thinking in those comments down below. Also, while you're at it, if you like this video, hit that like button. If you're new here, hit that subscribe button. Also, if you missed yesterday's show, you want to catch up, click or tap right there. Or if you want to watch a brand new podcast, click or tap right there. But that said, of course, as always, my name's Philip DeFranco. You've just been filled in. I love yo faces, and I'll see you tomorrow.